Hi, I'm Kate, and on this episode of Bite Sized, we're talking about mozzarella. Now, we've actually already done a video on mozzarella before, but what we found is that one out of all of our cheese lessons, mozzarella is the most popular, and we get it. We were super excited about making it too. But two, mozzarella is actually the most finicky and kind of the least accessible. Now, that's not to scare you off, but it is to let you know that there are certain factors that you really need to pay attention to when making mozzarella. Whether you've tried making mozzarella before and it didn't go so well, or you just want to set yourself up for success, we've got you covered.
Just a quick note, this video is focused on troubleshooting mozzarella, not the step-by-step process. In order to see the step-by-step process, check out our brief video here.
Now, we've actually done about 20 different trials of making mozzarella. Most of them have been off camera, but over that period of time, we found some specific trends and also regional differences. Now, the most important thing when it comes to making mozzarella is the type of milk. You need a low temperature pasteurized, non-homogenized milk in order to have the most success. Every time we've used this type of milk, it's gone pretty much perfectly and really smoothly, and it feels like, oh my gosh, this is so easy. But then other times when we've either used milk that we thought was similar and it was a local milk, or we just tried a more accessible, cheaper milk, well, it didn't go so great. Okay, so you might be wondering, why wouldn't I just go get a low temperature pasteurized, non-homogenized milk? Well, they aren't always so easy to come by. And we found that depending on where you are, it might be easier and it might be harder. Now, most milks in the grocery store are going to be pretty much the exact opposite. As we can see here on the label, this is ultra-pasteurized and non-homogenized. And that's what we've noticed that about 90% of the milks in the grocery store are. In order to find that low-temperature pasteurized, non-homogenized milk, you're going to have to seek it out. Now, you might be able to find it at a local farm. Generally, we have found that local milks are your best bet, but they aren't always this type of milk. So why does this all matter? Well, pasteurization is legally required in the US for all milks, and it's heating the milk to a certain temperature to kill microbes. Now, there are different types of pasteurization, like we've just noticed here, and it basically has to do with the temperature in which the milk is actually heated to. Ultra pasteurization is going to be the highest heat, whereas low temperature pasteurization will be at a lower heat. Now, this matters because heat, in addition to killing harmful microbes, also denatures proteins. And well, if you've seen any of our other lessons, you know that those proteins play a key role in the cheese making process, which is why most cheesemakers are going to look for a low temp pasteurized, non-homogenized milk or milk that's coming straight from the farm. Okay, so we understand that getting low temperature pasteurized, non-homogenized milk or even local milk sometimes can be a little bit tricky and it's more expensive. So if you're looking for something that's a little bit more accessible, we highly recommend checking out our paneer or ricotta labs. We've created them specifically because they can be so accessible and fairly forgiving. We've tried them on all different types of milk, including ultra-pasteurized homogenized milk. All right, so let's actually get to looking at these trials side by side.
So for trial one, we wanted to test two different types of milk. We have our low temperature pasteurized non-homogenized milk, our kind of ideal milk, which was local, and we can clearly see it on the label. And then we have a store-bought commercial brand that is ultra pasteurized and homogenized. Again, that's what you will normally see in the grocery store. So pretty much from the get-go, we see big differences in how the curds are setting and coagulating. The ultra-pasteurized milk is a little bit grainier, and it doesn't look like it's gelling completely together. It just doesn't look as smooth, whereas the non-homogenized low-temperature pasteurized milk has curds that are larger, smoother, and just seem more set and gelled together. As we continue to strain out the curds and stretch them, the differences become even more pronounced. As we strain the curds, we can see again that the ultra-pasteurized milk is a lot grainier, and it's not coming together very well. It's kind of crumbling in our hands, whereas with the non-homogenized, low-temperature pasteurized milk, it looks a lot more gelled together, and while it's not stretchy, it's not crumbling apart in the same way. And when we stretch the curds, which involves heating and then stretching them, we can see that the low temperature pasteurized non-homogenized milk, it stretches beautifully. It's perfect. And this is what we had the first time we did mozzarella. And it's what we've had basically every single time we've used this type of milk. It stretches very easily and it's super satisfying. However, it's a totally different story with ultra pasteurized milk. You can see it's basically just an attempt. It dissolves right into the leftover whey liquid and it's not coming together at all. And even when we tried to really use force and pressure with our hands and we could get some form of curds, it was still pretty lame. It doesn't look like mozzarella. It's definitely not stretchy and it's not smooth.
Okay, so hopefully you can see that there's a really big difference between the two different types of milk. However, here's another issue where it gets even more complex. Whenever we've been in the Northeast, we have not been able to find low temperature pasteurized non-homogenized milk, even when we've looked for it. Generally speaking, we found that the local milks don't necessarily specify the exact type of pasteurization it's used, and while it doesn't look like it's ultra-pasteurized, it also doesn't look like it's low-temperature pasteurized. So here's what we found in those trials.
So in this trial, we used a local milk that was a little confusing. It was a local milk we found in Boston. The label said it was homogenized, but it wasn't super clear exactly how it was pasteurized. When we went to the website, it didn't specify that it was low temperature pasteurized, but it also said it wasn't ultra pasteurized. So as we began the process, we saw pretty good results with our curds. They were shiny, they were setting quite well, they weren't quite as firm as our low temperature pasteurized non-homogenized milk, but looked definitely better than the ultra pasteurized milk, and overall we felt pretty good about them. However, when we got to the step of stretching, which is where we have seen the most issues, well, we ran into the same issues. The curds essentially dissolved in the whey liquid. And we do want to note, because it was so obvious in this trial, and we also heard this in our teacher workshop, that when it's dissolving into the liquid, you just notice the heat of the whey liquid so much more, probably because your hands are in the liquid for much longer and you're kind of fishing around for the curds. So it feels like it's burning your hands and it's just a really unenjoyable process. Based on these initial results, we decided to try the same milk, but switch up the stretching process. This time, we tried the microwave method. Essentially, we're still heating the curds, but instead of heating them by placing them in very hot whey liquid, we're just putting them in the microwave in about 30-second increments. This actually worked a lot better. It might not look like it here, and it's still definitely not perfect, but we had a little bit of stretching, and it certainly wasn't crumbling in the same way. So here, you can see our methods side by side. With the microwave method, it's actually stretching quite well and looks fairly similar to a store-bought mozzarella. Whereas with the stovetop method, it pretty much just crumbles. There's definitely no stretchiness, almost at all. It's pretty similar to what the curds actually look like before stretching. So microwave method was definitely the way to go. So given these unexpected results and change in plan, we decided we wanted to do one more test to really look closely at this microwave method and reconsider if we should be doing that method over the stovetop method. So we tried this out with our ideal milk, the low temperature pasteurized non-homogenized milk, and we found that it worked great. While we didn't notice a huge difference in the final product between the stovetop method and the microwave method, to be honest, we'll probably do the microwave method in the future. It just was a little bit easier, a little bit cleaner, and while you can't be quite as precise in the exact temperature you are heating the curd to, we found that as long as we did 30-second increments or maybe even 15-second increments for smaller amounts of mozzarella, it worked just fine. Now, the last thing we do want to note is that we tested out three other different types of low-temperature pasteurized non-homogenized milk to make sure it wasn't the exact brand that we were using, and they all worked great. In particular, this brand we have found is somewhat nationwide, so you might want to check it out.
Now, while we've actually done a good amount of trials, and we're pretty pleased with what we have found, this obviously is still a limited data set. So if you find something new to share, we'd love to hear it, and we think others would too. Be sure to drop a comment below. We hope you enjoyed this somewhat unique episode of Bite Size. Be sure to like and subscribe for more videos.